Oprah said, where there is no struggle, there is no strength. On this episode, we'll discover how Brittany Quiroz, aka a hot MS, chose to see how her pain revealed her purpose and expanding the perceptions of disability. But before we jump in, I'd like to remind you to please subscribe and share. And if you'd like to join my community more in depth, you can go to my private Facebook group called Victoriously Living. And if you'd like to see more from One Leg Up Productions, you can support us at patreon.com/OneLegUpProductions. Hi, welcome to Chair Chats, the lifestyle talk show with a disability twist. I'm your host, Pauline Victoria. Today, we're going to be interviewing Brittany Quiroz, aka a hot MS, about her recent diagnosis of multiple sclerosis and how it acted as a catalyst to fulfill her purpose and refine her strength through her struggles. Thank you, Brittany, for joining us today.
Hi, Pauline. Thank you so, so much for having me. I'm so excited to get on and talk with you and share my message and my story.
I'd love to have our viewers get to know you. So if you could tell us a little bit about who you are and your recent diagnosis and how you processed it.
Absolutely. So being diagnosed with a disability, chronic illness, in this case, multiple sclerosis, I was diagnosed in September of last year, 2019. So it's been about seven and a half months now. I don't know, what month are we in? This is like, I don't even know what week it is. But it was a lot. I was 2 months away from my 31st birthday. So happy birthday. It's not, you know, something that anybody wants to get as news. But I like to explain my diagnosis in like a 5 second time frame. First second was panic. Second second was why. Third second was, I think, panic again. You know, how is this happening? Confusion, fear. But then the fourth and fifth second was really a moment of, okay, this is what I'm being given. It was a fight or flight, do or die moment of determination of, I'm gonna make this and turn it into something beautiful and something positive and uplifting. So since then, I have gotten kind of hip. I finally learned and utilized a hashtag correctly. I was still saying it was a sharp. I'm a musician, so I'm like, it's a sharp, it's not a hashtag. So I got, you know, kind of familiar with how to start a blog. I started a website, started my Instagram, my Facebook, I tweet. I'm still learning how to fly and tweet, so. But for me, it was kind of, if I was able to put myself out there and share my story and share what I was going through, even though I knew nothing of the disability and the illness, it was making it more real for me. But it was also allowing other people that are just newly diagnosed and just figuring out what their, you know, path is in this new normal, that you will, that they were figuring out that, hey, I'm not alone and being confused and lost and terrified and ugly crying and a mess and everything. So I kind of started on a quest of putting it all out there with limited filters and trying to make a difference and break that stigma of what disability looks like. Because you never ever would think that, oh, when I grow up one day, I'm going to be, you know, a motivational speaker for the disabled community or just for positivity in general. For, you know, the fact of having a chronic illness like MS, it's like, you don't think that. You think firefighter, singer, doctor, you know. So again, I kind of honed in on taking what I was given and have been figuring out how to use it for something empowering and something beautiful.
5 seconds. What you did in 5 seconds, people often can't do in 5 years. You know, I understand, like, we understand that there's this whole process of grief that we go through. And I think whether it be someone we lose or some sort of functionality in our body or having to adopt a new lifestyle because our body isn't the way it used to. It's a grieving process, and you went through it so quickly. I'd love to find out how.
Sure. And, you know, grief is such a sensitive topic because it's not one size fits all, you know, it's something that you order online. It's like, there are so many different customizing factors that can play into the process of grief, and everybody's going to do it different. And for everyone, it's going to look different. For me, having that 5 second fear, panic, why, and then, you know, guns up, I'm going to handle this. I think it came from me experiencing the dark side for a while. Years prior, unfortunately, I can't even say unfortunately. I'm going to take that back because nothing happens unfortunately. Everything happens for a reason. So I just checked myself there. But years ago, I was in an abusive marriage. I knew very little about alcoholism or drug use. I know it doesn't look like it. They're like, oh, the tattoo girl doesn't know about this. It's like, tattoos are a very artistic form. And again, it's breaking the stigma and the stereotype of what is associated with, you know, somebody with body art. Anyhow, I was in this marriage and started seeing who he really was. I was a victim of domestic violence, and I fell into a depression for almost 4 years. At one point towards the end, before I had gained up the courage and the strength, and I know God was a huge contributor to getting me out of this, or out of that at the time. I remember even calling my mom and saying, I can't figure out how to brush my teeth. And she thought that I was kidding. And I was legitimately straight up so mentally gone in losing myself in trying to hold this marriage together and trying to get this person that was struggling with addiction help, that didn't want help. And, you know, I was mentally gone. So I think, having seen so closely what it is like to be in your own level of legitimate hell, it was when I got the diagnosis, I knew that Brittany, I have the capability of allowing my brain to go to a dark place. I have the capability of overeating and getting a really, really bad habit. At the time, I was significantly overweight for my height and for my own body. I was not healthy, and I knew firsthand that I have the tendencies of going down that road again. And I was like, no, I got myself out of that situation. I'm married to an incredible man now who is my gift from God and my angel that was sent from the heavens. You know, I have a beautiful family. I have 2 children. I'm not going to allow myself to go down that road again. So I think having been dragged through hell, and then given something that could potentially bring me down that hell road again, was like, not today, Satan. It's not going to happen. I'm not going to allow it to happen. I got to flip this, and I got to do it now.
For my truth, it's also understanding that there's something bigger at play here. It's not just about self-reliance. It's reliance on our community, on people around us, our husbands. And foremost and most importantly, God. I mean, he is the source of everything for me. And it sounds like he's provided quite a bit of comfort. And
absolutely.
To be able to go from, your necklace. So my necklace, that is my wedding ring, actually, since I don't
have it. Oh, I love it.
I don't know if you could see it. But
yeah.
The other thing I wanted to talk about was you felt like your purpose was to help expand the perceptions of disability. So in your thoughts, what do you think is the current perception of disability?
I think society as a whole has been taught to view disability, I don't want to say in a limited source, because then you have people of culture and you know, members of our culture and members of our society that do see a wider lens of what it looks like. But again, it's a simple association of going back to grade school. Okay. You have, you know, roles, and then you have an object that is associated with those roles. So apple would go to teacher, donut could go to policeman, you know, stethoscope could go to doctor. We have a blue placard with a white stick figure in a wheelchair. That is what we've associated mentally, a visual correlation of what disability looks like. However, just like with MS or spinal injuries or fibromyalgia or Crohn's disease, you don't get an icon of somebody sitting with their stomach hunched over on a toilet to effectively depict what Crohn's disease entails. We don't see that. We have one label and that's it. So why I do what I do, and people ask me, and I got a lot of positive feedback in the beginning of this quest, I guess you could say, my mission. And then I got a lot of negative feedback of people saying, well, why are you putting it all out there? Don't you get enough attention? And it's like, look, first of all, I look like this. You notice me. Second of all, I'm an old theater kid. If I want to get attention, trust me, there is a billion ways that I can do that. The reason why I choose to share is to widen that lens and break that stigma of saying just because you can't see it does not mean that it doesn't exist. Just because you may not know about it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. So I've had people, strangers, look at me when I'm, you know, walking somewhere with my walking cane and say, oh, you know, oh, you're too young to have a cane. Or they'll even touch it, which is like so weird. Don't come in my bubble. You know, but it's like I could take the automatic reaction and get defensive and get negative and say, I have MS, what's wrong with you? Blah, 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 blah. Or I can change the perspective and change the I don't want to say the attack, but the method of how I choose to respond of saying, hey, have you heard about MS? It's a neurological disorder. It attacks this, it does this, it makes that, anybody can have it. Crazy, right? And you kind of break the ice. So that's kind of the position that I've allowed myself to be in. It's vulnerable. It's my personal medical history that does not need to be shared with anybody. But if we don't put ourselves in, you know, being comfortable with being uncomfortable, we're going to stay in this tiny little spot of awareness rather than being vulnerable and putting it all out there and getting people to see this wider lens of what they don't know and what's real.
There are stigmas, there are stereotypes of people with disabilities, but unless we take our power back and say we're going to be different about it, it will never change. And absolutely, that whole disabled, angry disabled person is such a stigma that I definitely try to stay away from. I actually just interviewed someone recently and they were a spinal cord injury. And pretty much as soon as she broke her neck, her mom was like, you know, you represent the disabled community now. It's not just about you. And I've always felt that, right, wrong, or indifferent, I am sure there are going to be people with disabilities that disagree with me. But I personally take it on as a personal responsibility to try to show up as someone that is willing to have a conversation for the sake of understanding and bridging those gaps where ignorance exists. And I think we all have the power to do that in how we respond to our circumstances, whether that be someone in our face or whether that be MS staring at us, right? So understanding that personal power to choose how we respond is a huge asset that I think a lot of us forget, disabled or not. You know, this is just right. Human nature. It doesn't even matter if you have a disability or not at this point. And so a lot of times it could be our own made up disabilities in our mind that are actually more disabling than the actual condition, the chronic illness or the disability or the spinal cord injury, whatever it is, that is probably more disabling than anything else. And I'd love to ask you what advice would you give to somebody who is to go from depression and defeat to purpose and positivity?
That's a hard one because you have to ride it out. If at the time when I was in this marriage, my first marriage, I had so much support and I had so many people cheering me on to gain my self-confidence back and pull myself out of the situation. I'll tell you what, it does not matter if you've got a parade running down your street saying, leave him, you deserve better. there, nobody can tell you anything that will convince you to actually take the action to get yourself out of a situation. So by going the path, it can get messy, it can get ugly, it can get awful, it can get traumatic. I believe wholeheartedly that no matter what you go through, you were designed to go through it, you were supposed to go through it, and you were meant to overcome it, 100%. Great things are not accomplished by people that have it easy. God, that's not the, and if you're a believer, amazing, wonderful, thank you. If you're not, the same thing applies. It doesn't matter. Everything happens for a reason. So I believe God set me up to go through the path. And if I was given the opportunity to choose, oh, would you go through it all again? I know there's a lot of people out there that would say, no way, I wouldn't go through it again. Me personally, with my story and my path, I would absolutely do it tenfold. I would do it all over again because it has grounded me. It has made me have self-worth. It has made me have confidence again. It has made me know what it is like to have real relationship. I have the relationship back with my family, but it's all part of the bigger picture. So we can't embrace our victories and praise ourselves and pat ourselves in the back for succeeding at something if we don't give recognition that it is due to the hell that it took us to get there.
Amen.
Can't have one without the other.
Woo! Woo! Okay. I'm just want to be like, preach.
Preach it. But it's true. Like, you cannot have one without the other. It's like, just like you can't have heaven without hell. You can't have happiness without pain. It's like, nobody's life is that easy unless you're like Elmo on Sesame Street.
Which is make-believe, people.
Exactly.
The principle of opposites, right? The principle of opposites. Everything that you described that it gave you, you would think it would strip you of, you know, relations back with your family, self-confidence, worth, value. Most of the times when we're hit by a truck, like MS, those are things that are ripped from us too. And yet you say you gained those, and that is so beautiful. I just want to find out how did that happen?
Well, I think a lot of it contributes to my background in music, and acting and theater and stage and whatnot. So I had been in shows and done theater and done film and TV, and, you know, singing professionally since I was five, whether it be through Disney, Nickelodeon, whatever have you, you know, local productions in Massachusetts where I grew up in Boston. And I remember being taught at a very young age, the typical phrase that we always hear, the show must go on, the show must go on. Sorry, I had to do that. But it's true. The show has to go on. So for me, I was put at a young age in a situations where I had to perform. I had a show. I may have been sick. I may have been dealing with my parents' divorce at a young age, which is something that a lot of kids go through, you know, being bullied in school. And I was tiny. So luckily enough, I was small enough to be comfortable when I got shoved in a locker, you know, in the first grade. I so could have, Pauline, I could have made a career out of being one of those girls, like at the circus with the magic shows that pop out of the box, because I could like contort myself and like get myself to fit in there. But I had to still pull it together and perform or go sing or do something regardless of what had happened moments before. So when I got diagnosed, it's like, okay, this is my role. I have to do it. I don't have a choice. I have to figure it out. And that's kind of what has allowed me to, I think, be more accepting and more adapting of it, because it's kind of like the role that I have to play now, because it is me. Now, not to say that, oh, MS is defining who I am. No, not at all. I'm, you know, I'm a mom, I'm a musician. I'm, you know, I'm trying to now get creative with art as far as depicting a message in a photograph as the model. So I'm all over the place. But having that background of get on stage and figure it out and do it regardless, you know, I've done shows and my grandfather died hours before the performance.
Oh, wow.
So terrible. And my mom, you know, she went through the same thing where my grandmother, when I was six, she was performing. She had a huge show. She's a pianist, professional composer and pianist. And my Nina was in the hospital, was ready to die, and she died while my mom was playing. So it's like, I come from a long line of warriors.
Mm-hmm, I would say so.
People that have gone through really, really tough stuff, but it's like, it's all about how you choose to perceive it and what you choose to do with it. You can focus on the negative, you can focus on the trauma and the sadness and the sorrow, which is okay, and you should, because it's hard and it sucks and it's painful. But the key is what you do after. What do you, how do you use it? How do you turn it into something beautiful? So for me, having been a songwriter for over 15 years now, you know, writing about relationships and writing about lost love and writing about pain, again, in that like first few days of diagnosis, it was like God was shouting to me, okay, yo, now you know what I want your message to be, go preach it. You know what I mean? So now I only write motivational music. My focus is on sharing my message to motivate people, because since starting the Instagram and the website and the Facebook, whatever have you, I mean, I could send carrier pigeons around. It doesn't matter what platform it is. I'm hearing so many messages back of people saying, I wish I was positive like you. I'm so inspired, but I don't have the confidence to do it. And it's like, that is why I do this. That is what I want to change. I want everybody to see and understand that it's okay to be the underdog. It's okay to not be the best at something. You know, it's okay to ugly cry. It's like, stop faulting ourselves. We have to stop faulting ourselves. We have to start loving all of the crap just as much as every part of ourselves that is beautiful and good.
Yeah, that's beautiful. How can we support a hot MS? You have a website. What's that website?
So I have a website. It's www.ahotms. Get it? Like a hot mess. But that's me being lame and funny. You can also find me on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at ahotms. And I'm always trying to, you know, be really on top of, you know, direct messages that are coming through. So if you're watching, please don't hesitate to reach out. You know, again, this is all community and we're all in this together. It doesn't matter. MS, spinal cord injury, you know, amputations, birth defects. We're all under the same umbrella of, it's not ideal, but we're making it work.
Absolutely. Love it. That's a beautiful message to end on. Thank you so much. I am so grateful for everything that you're doing, for yourself, for our community. I think the best thing you can do for another person is to be the change. I know it sounds cliche, be the change you want to see in the world, Gandhi. Yes. Thank you. But it is so true, you know, and you are a great example of what's possible when we are able to expand our perspectives and see our struggles and our pain as our purpose. And I would love to hear from you, the viewer, what would open up for you if you expanded your perspectives and perceptions in your life and about your circumstances? And rather than living from your circumstances, what if you lived from possibility? Thank you, Brittany, so much for being with us today.
Thank you, Colleen, for having me so much.
Your interview was so life-giving. So I know that other people will get so much out of it. Before we close, I want to also remind you, the viewer, to please subscribe and share. I feel like this episode will be so beneficial to so many people, whether they have a disability or not. And so if you'd like to share this episode, I would encourage you to do that. I'd love for you to also participate in my community by joining my private Facebook group called Victoriously Living. And if you'd like to see more from One Leg Up Productions, please subscribe to us at patreon.com/One Leg Up Productions. Thank you so much and be blessed.